In the great expanses of science fiction, there is a deep ocean of discussion and debate. Now, I'm not referring to the common internet debates of Twitter, Reddit, and 4chan. I'm referring to literary analysis. There is something about science fiction that demands a deeper exchange of ideas, even when the text itself is pretty plain and straightforward. If I were to ask you, which of the science fiction films or franchises is responsible for the largest body of academic work, what would you really say? Blade Runner? Star Wars? 2001 A Space Odyssey? While these films do have a respectable body of work around them, there is one that takes the cake. Alien. Yes, surprisingly, Alien has been the subject in more academic papers than the previously mentioned works. Running at just under 2 hours, Alien is a film that does a lot while actually showing very little. Save for the third act, the alien itself is only shown for a few moments. Yet despite this, the Alien franchise has spawned an entire subgenre of literary analysis and study. Director Ridley Scott has insisted that Alien has no deeper meaning or layers, saying, "It has absolutely no message. It works on a very visceral level, and its only point is terror and more terror." And having watched this film for this video essay, I'm inclined to believe him. However, this hasn't stopped academics from writing papers on the sci-fi horror classic for nearly 40 years. Every aspect of this film has lent itself to analysis. The design of the xenomorph itself has been hotly studied for Freudian psychology. I mean, just look at this thing. People who study Freud have had a field day with just its design, its physiology, the way it's breeding and reproduction. The film has been under a critical lens from every conceivable academic field, from psychoanalytic, to feminist and humanist theory, to even Marxist and communist critique. Through all the scenes of xenomorph chest popping and crowded ventilation shaft jump scares, scholars have butt heads on a key moment in the original film, and it has to do with the main character, everyone's favorite xenomorph fighting survivor, Ellen Ripley, and what can only be described as the most important pair of panties in science fiction. In the original film, after everything that has happened, after her entire crew was slaughtered, she barely made it out alive, our triumphant heroine disrobes from her uniform, the long sigh of a job well survived. For this third act, when Ripley is in a plain white tee and panty, she manages to get into a spacesuit and launch the stowaway alien into space. However, scholars have offered differing interpretations and opinions on this scene. Judith Newton explains her interpretation in her paper, Feminism and Anxiety in Alien, commenting on Ellen Ripley's appearance to the audience. Ripley is not only divested of coalition and reinvested with femininity, she is also reaffirmed as a company woman. Though in many ways a fine and thrilling hero, she is robbed of radical thrust. Now, I'm not entirely sure what radical thrust means in this context, though this is to say that while Ellen Ripley has taken over the previously male-dominated role, both literally by being the last survivor on her ship, and metaphorically by being a heroine in a science fiction horror movie dominated by male leads, she is quoted, robbed of her previous actions by now appealing to her femininity and to express herself in this way. Of course, this isn't just one interpretation, as scholar and literary critic James Kavanaugh, different Kavanaugh, counters with his own view of the scantily clad Ripley in his paper, Son of a Bitch, Feminism and Humanism in Alien, saying, such criticisms would be hard-pressed to avoid repressive and self-defeating assumptions about what constitutes as sexism, and irrelevant assumptions about what constitutes the film and its ideological discourse. He goes on to say that the images presented to the viewer are hardly sensational by any standards, and it seems senseless for a progressive criticism to construct from it as a general condemnation of the film that denies all the other effects of a fairly consistent feminist statement. Now, to put it simply, Kavanaugh is stating that Ellen Ripley appearing in her underwear is not inherently sexist, yet criticizing this film for being sexist is, in fact, sexist, and in doing so undermines the film's previous demonstrations as a positive feminist text. There were similar pieces like this floating around in academia, and in the early days of alien studies, it seemed that there were two schools of thought, and it all centered around a pair of granny panties. The panty haters decried the panty lovers that were not being critical enough of the text, going so far as to accuse this party of uncritical phallocentrism. Phallocentrism is a fancy term referring to the ideology that the wiener is the central element in the organization of the social world. Power to the wiener. However, panty lovers have accused the other party of pushing repressive, self-defeating assumptions about what exactly is sexism. And to put it plainly, it seems that we have a divide where the panty haters are sex negative and the panty lovers are sex positive. This created a small micro schism within the field of alien academic subgenres. However, a middle ground was proposed by Barbara Creed in her paper, Horror and the Monstrous Feminism, an Imaginary Objection. She comments on the riff in this field of thought by saying, "Much has been written about the final scene in which Ripley undresses before the camera, on the grounds that its voyeurism undermines her role as a successful heroine. But what is Barbara's solution?" Well, she explains further by saying, "What if Ripley, in her panties, signifies the acceptable form and shape of woman? The display of a woman is reassuring and a pleasurable sign." Listen, in this world of deep space aliens, terror, rebirth through facehuggers, and cyborg murder, at the end of the day, Ellen Ripley is just a woman. She doesn't have any sort of superpowers or extraterrestrial strengths, and seeing her in this way is just a return to center. Not in an objectifying way, but it's normal. It's comforting. After this very unnatural adventure and the stresses and terror, Ellen does something that is all too human. Even after the alien is defeated for good, what does she do? She takes Charles, she goes into stasis, sleeping off this nightmare and hoping the next time she wakes up, everything will be A-okay. We as viewers know, in later films, everything is not A-okay. We'll let her have this moment of peace at the end of the first film. I mean, I can surely relate, just coming off of a long day of work, and the first thing I do, kick off my shoes, take my pants off. That's right. It's natural. Ripley is finally in a place where she feels safe, and before the discovery of the alien stowing away with her, it is. Alien continues to penetrate the minds of sci-fi fans and scholars alike. Next month, Alien turns 40, and it has been the subject of countless papers, talked about decades after its initial release back in 1979, and will most likely continue to do so far into the future. While we may further look into this franchise for deeper meanings, exchange of ideas, and other lenses to put it to, we can do so in the familiar, the comfort of our own home, and the safety of our own underoos. Despite everything, it's still you.